Hello, and welcome back to these virtual oceans. So, first things first, as you can probably gather by looking at the length of this, things got just a little bit out of hand. It's been 2 years since I put together the first video, and you might be thinking there isn't too much reason to make a follow-up, but, funnily enough, quite a bit has happened since then. The more I held off on putting this video together, the more games would keep popping up, and so here we are with another somewhat long editorial. Now, the purpose of this video, and the original for that matter, isn't just to list off every single shark that's ever been in a video game, though I've included quite a few in this opening montage. This is a bit more about looking at a selection of games with some notable shark sequences in greater detail, and also to look at the graphical quality. We'll also look into how they are integrated into the gameplay and how they are portrayed. Somewhat inherently, this tends to be in a negative light, as sharks will normally be used as enemies or obstacles to hinder or prevent progress. In most cases though, that's just game design. Even with animals like sharks, which have such a deeply ingrained negative public image, there are very, very, very few examples of them being the primary threat in any game, and only a handful where they are the one and only threat to be found, such as in Shark, Hunting the Great White. Even Jaws on the NES had other enemies like jellyfish. When it comes to games, just about anything can be a threat to your very existence, like these familiar critters. There's even a cat version of a Goomba, for goodness sake. Nonetheless, we'll be sure to point out the exceptions of completely harmless sharks wherever they do occur. Any sane person wouldn't consider keeping a great white as a pet, and for a variety of very good reasons.
Sorry, Batman. Did I forget to mention my little friend down there? Meet Tiny. Who'd have thought a big fish could be so useful? Not me, that's for sure. He's like a mobile garbage truck. Whatever I drop in that tank just vanishes. Poof. Problem got.
Well, the sanity of Oswald Cobblepot, aka the Penguin, has always been more than a little bit questionable.
Listen, I'm what you might call a collector. If someone wants it, I'll have to think I've got it. And if I don't have it, I'll get it.
Welcome to Batman Arkham City, Rocksteady's mega sequel to Arkham Asylum, the series that redefined what a superhero game could be. Of course, this tank is nowhere near large enough to accommodate an adult great white shark, let alone one of this size, but hey, video games. Now, Batman has his own little history with sharks, as I'm sure most of you are aware. Most famously, during the feature-length adaptation of the 1966 Batman series starring Adam West. In the opening few minutes, a shark stuffed with explosives chomped down on the toughest pair of tights known to mankind, all whilst Batman demonstrated a variety of ways to punch a rubber fish. It also gave us the immortal line,
"Hand me down the shark repellent bat spray!"
Glorious. This specific sequence would actually be referenced in Rocksteady's third Batman game, Arkham Knight. There is a DLC racetrack for the game based around the set of the 1966 movie, which includes a jump over a water tank complete with the Batcopter and fake shark fin. For the most part, Tiny is simply a punishment for rushing across the fragile ice layer too quickly. You run, you break the ice, you get eaten by the shark. The Penguin's pet would only be briefly referenced in the game's sequel, during a conversation between some henchmen. The corpse of a great white, strung up by its tail over the dock, led to some speculation that this was the same shark. However, the release of the GCPD Lockdown DLC, set shortly after the events of the main game, disproves this. Of course, great whites can't really remain motionless in the water like this, but as we've said before, video games. It's more of an Easter egg than anything else, something that you might notice before it swims off into the distance mid-battle. Yeesh, Tiny really doesn't like masked vigilantes. You almost wonder if it's a blood relative to that shark from 1966 and we have some Jaws the Revenge-esque voodoo shark storyline going on here.
Anyone want a slightly used bat suit? I'm sure the blood will wash off.
And now it's time to return to the deep blue seas of San Andreas. Last time we talked a bit about the history of sharks in the Grand Theft Auto series and, wouldn't you know it, in bringing this amazing technical achievement to 8th generation consoles and PC, Rockstar really went all out on expanding the game. Right here, we're using the PC version. The frame rate might have been a clue. What were once quite barren and depressing depths with only a few fish and the occasional tiger shark for company are now populated by more species of fish, stingrays, orca, dolphins, humpback whales, and a new species of shark, the hammerhead. Thank you. As a sandbox, it's hard to fault what this game has become. There's absolutely no point at all in these schooling hammerheads gathering offshore, just minding their own business, but it's great to see. Most species of hammerhead shark are notorious for being very wary of swimmers and, especially, divers. The most common theory being that they have a strong dislike of the sight and sound created by bubbles from scuba gear. There's anecdotal evidence to back this up, as divers using near-silent rebreathers that don't generate much in the way of bubbles have typically had much greater success encountering and getting closer to hammerheads than those using scuba gear. That's not really any different in the game either. Grand Theft Auto's hammerhead sharks are completely docile and will not attack the player under any circumstances. They will actively avoid your attempts to swim close to them. As for the returning tiger sharks, that's a bit more complicated. Generally, my observations from the last generation version of GTA 5 hold true. Provided you can keep facing them, they will typically not attack and will circle you and eventually just swim far enough away that their AI will switch off. When this happens, they will literally just hold position in the distance, only switching back on when you swim closer. This would likely just be a game engine limitation by design, that certain AI types will become inactive when a certain distance away from the player for the sake of performance. However, actively swimming around with one nearby is something to be extremely careful of, especially if you are lacking scuba gear. Within the game, these sharks are more aggressive towards swimmers at the surface because it's harder to keep an eye on them. Their attack pattern is generally from below and behind, so if you can take measures to prevent this from happening, you'll be at less risk. Another new addition to this next generation version of Grand Theft Auto 5 is the peyote plant. These plants are hidden around the game world and each can only be used once. And if you were to consume one... Welcome to our first playable sharks of the day. The peyote plants will let you inhabit the body of any wildlife in the game. What animal you will become is completely random, though is based upon the location of the plant. Different regions will generally offer different animals. The one that can be found underwater by Del Piero Pier will allow you to become either a tiger or hammerhead shark. This was actually the definitive proof that the original GTA 5 sharks were tigers, as Trevor will state as such when using a peyote.
I'm a shark? I'm a fucking shark? A fucking hammerhead shark? Fuck, you kidding me? I look stupid. I don't look hard, I look dumb. Dumb and angry and bitter, just like I always am. Only now I'm a shark with eyes too far apart. Gosh, I should eat someone for this. This is an outrage. I want to eat someone. Any fucker less than me. Now you're getting
The 3D models are okay, but not really all that accurate. With both sharks, the tail is too small, and the hammerhead suffers with a very limp example. credit to Rockstar, though, the Tiger Shark does at least have the correct teeth, but the body itself is very stocky. Little fatties, these chaps. While tigers can grow to similar lengths as a great white, being a member of the Requiem shark family, they tend to be far less bulky. Unless it was full of pups, a tiger shark will almost always weigh considerably less than a great white of the same length. This is Abzu, the upcoming underwater adventure game from the creators of Journey. I really wish I could show a bit more of this beautiful and highly stylized world, but footage and images are incredibly limited at this point in time. So far we've seen a number of shark species, including reef sharks, thresher sharks, whale sharks, oceanic white tips, and, of course, a great white. The game is due out in August for the PlayStation 4 and PC. I'm really looking forward to it, actually. The sci-fi undertones suggested will probably make this the closest thing to an Echo the Dolphin game in almost two decades. Let's take a little detour now. In the first video, we looked at Endless Ocean 2, Adventures of the Deep, pretty extensively. Understandable, because the game featured so many shark species, ranging from famous ones such as the great white, the tiger, whale, and hammerhead sharks, to much lesser known species like the frilled, megamouth, blunt-nosed sixgill, and epaulette sharks. More than 20 different types of sharks in total. That said, we didn't look at the first game at all, in part because I no longer own the game to record from it, but mostly because the sequel had pretty much everything the first game did, plus a whole lot more. On top of that, some, though not all, of the models had been remade to a high level of detail. For example, these great whites in Endless Ocean 2 and these are the great whites from the first game. Honestly, these look more like grey tip reef sharks or a similar Requiem species. They don't even really look like juvenile great whites. There was one sole exception to this, however. This is Magu Tapa, a large and, when you consider the limitations of the Wii hardware, a really well-modelled great white shark. I'm going to let Zorak of An Orbital Grouse take over here for a little bit with a clip from his Let's Play, used with permission.
Magu Tapa, translating to the Cloak of Bloodstained Scars. Magu Tapa is the god of death and violence in the Manalai Sea, and one of the sons of the White Mother. He's basically a very big and very mean great white shark. Just look at this guy. Sharks feature very heavily into Polynesian religions and mythology. More than a few have several shark deities. They fill many different roles. Gods of death and violence, war, and of course, the ocean. Generally speaking, though, most real Polynesian religions lack any documented evidence of a researcher finding an avatar of their god of death. I should probably stop poking him. That seems like a really bad idea.
Ah, Thank you, Zorak. We'll be hearing a little bit more from him and his compatriot Chorocojo a little later on. Together they form the heart of an orbital grouse, and you can find their complete let's plays of both Endless Ocean titles on their channel by clicking the link. There's plenty of laughs and also plenty to learn from numerous informative cutaways, so highly recommended. Back to the game itself, Magu Tappa formed the basis for the Thanatos model seen in the second game. Essentially, they took the Magu Tappa 3D model and made it more fanciful, with elongated fins being the most obvious change. These are still pretty good models all things considered, though the tail could be improved a bit. Great Whites are members of the Lamnidae family. One of the traits of that family of sharks is that the upper and lower lobes of the caudal fin, i.e. the tail, are of quite similar size, forming what is usually described as a crescent. This is a common trait amongst the world's fastest fish, such as swordfish, sailfish, marlin, the mako shark, and, of course, the great white. There was one other little difference in the first game. Welcome to Hell's Aquarium. Yes, once you've learnt an animal's information, you can add it to the aquarium, with the sole exception of the Great Mother, the whale god whale and main focus of the game's story. But Magu Tappa? No problem. This is just as well in a way, because the only normal way to encounter this shark is at night time in the ship's graveyard, which can be a pain to get to. If you want a really good look at Magu Tappa, then this is the way to do it. By now, the other really big difference between the two games should be quite apparent. Unlike the sequel, there are absolutely no aggressive animals in the original Endless Ocean. Even Magu Tappa doesn't care about your presence diving around on your own at night. There's no pulsar, and so no upset animals you need to pacify. That makes getting a closer look at some species, such as this blunt-nosed six-gill shark, much easier as it circles around the remains of this whale fall, which is quite an authentic behaviour. You know, this seems about as good a time as any. Chorocojo, please, take over.
Pyxagnathus is a genus comprising two sharks, the blunt-nosed six-gill shark and the big-eyed six-gill shark, hereafter called the quai six-gill shark. You may be wondering why they're called six-gill sharks. Of course, you may also not be, because it's painfully obvious. While not terribly uncommon in shallow water, Pyxagnathus both normally live greater than 90 meters down. Pretty neat, not that special. Until we found one swimming around, being awfully six-gilly at 1,875 meters. That's really deep. That's like 6,000 feet plus deep, so right there. They're large sharks, the blunt nose growing more than 18 feet in length. They're not picky eaters either. They'll test whatever they find for food. Hagfish, salmon, dead things, electrical cable. Xangas don't care. They're also found, well, everywhere. They've been found off of Florida, off of California, in the fjords of Norway, off of Australia, everywhere. The six-gill sharks are ancient, too. Like, really ancient. We found fossils almost identical to Xangas from the Triassic period. They look more like ancient sharks than most sharks people are commonly familiar with. Basically what I'm saying is there's a primeval, 20-ish foot, voracious, badass shark probably nearby you right now at this time. Even if you live like in Iowa, right now, holy shit, there's one right near you. That's crazy. I mean, the only thing more powerful than a six-gill shark would be like a seven-gill shark or something. And that's just... my god.
Seriously, people, if you're watching this, you've probably got a bit of an interest in sharks and maybe any other marine life. So go check their stuff out, it's a good time and you might enjoy some of their other stuff too. So that was Endless Ocean once again, but this video isn't meant to be just a rehash, and you might be wondering about any similar but nicer looking games on modern consoles or PC. Well, actually that's pretty slim pickings, but let's see what we can do. First up, we have a game in Steam Early Access called World of Diving. Unfortunately, this game has been in Steam Early Access for 2 years at this point and still shows no real sign of reaching completion anytime soon. The concept was always for a multiplayer diving experience with optional VR support that would let you explore, salvage, and socialise through virtual diving. However, development has been somewhat stalled for quite a while now, so this is going to be one of those cautionary tales. As it stands, there is currently just one shark species in the game, which is the bull shark shown here. And let's be honest, it's not the best 3D model in the world. I wouldn't even know what species it's supposed to be if it wasn't listed in the game's newly added Marine Encyclopedia feature. Thus far, the bull sharks are completely harmless, though I don't know if there is an intention to change that in the future. Also listed is a great white shark, although, as far as I'm aware, this is not yet implemented, and the only information we have on it is this screenshot and this tiny clip from a trailer which was also released 2 years ago. As stated, the game is nowhere near finished at this point, and is still prone to some rather bizarre glitches. Meanwhile, Depth Hunter 2 Deep Dive is probably the closest you'll get to an Endless Ocean experience on the PC. Whilst the game does have its photography and salvage related missions, there is one thing that does make it different from Endless Ocean, and that's the addition of spearfishing. There are a few sharks on display here, none of which can attack the player. Let's be clear though, you can't attack them either. Whilst smaller fish are fair game, a number of other animals, including sharks, rays, sea turtles and marine mammals, are all off limits. The only thing you'll be shooting these with is your camera. There are four species of shark to be found, and guess what? The great white is not one of them! Instead, we have the shortfin mako, Caribbean reef, tiger and goblin sharks instead. Unfortunately, none of them are particularly well rendered, with the mako being perhaps the most passable. Right here we can see the goblin shark and, well, that's the same old mistake you'll see in everything, which is the jaw is constantly protruding. Whilst this was also the case in Endless Ocean 2, the game did at least briefly show it correctly during a cutscene. In real life, the goblin shark only looks like this when it's projecting its jaws forward during feeding. Meanwhile, reef shot is entirely about taking photographs, be that of animals or of underwater artifacts. There's only two shark species in this game, one of which is quite obviously a hammerhead, and there's this species, which I will just say is unidentifiable, but is probably just your typical reef shark. Turning back the clock to 1997, this is Treasures of the Deep for the PlayStation. This underwater action shooter features a surprisingly large variety of sharks, and despite the limitations of the 32-bit system's graphics, I feel confident in identifying tiger, hammerhead, goblin, sand tiger, copper, blue, oceanic white tip, mako, leopard, thresher, Greenland, great white, basking, and whale sharks. Whew. All of which are hostile, with the sole exception of the whale shark. Yep, you heard that right. This game's basking sharks are inexplicably bloodthirsty, and I'm almost as surprised as a basking shark itself would be. Almost. Speaking of bloodthirsty, that is actually a mechanic in the game. Being injured will cause you to bleed, attracting sharks into attacking you. However, this works both ways. Anything that you attack and injure, such as an enemy diver, will begin to bleed themselves, causing sharks to attack them instead of you. The game has a variety of weapons, including a net, which can be used to capture enemies instead of killing them. Although this won't work on everything in the game, such as great whites. But the big surprise is the bonus stage. Shark Attack is a simple score attack mode where you find yourself playing as a great white shark with the simple goal of killing as much as you can within the time limit. It's basic, but interesting to see. In a way, this could be called the spiritual predecessor to Jaws Unleashed. Fast forward to 1998, and what a difference a year makes. This is The Ocean Hunter, an underwater on-rails shooter released by Sega using the Model 3 arcade board. A quick shout out now to Abelardo Vidal, who gave me permission to use footage from his full Let's Play of the game. Unlike most of the videos you'll find online, this one has been captured from an actual Model 3 circuit board, so everything looks exactly as it should. Emulating Model 3 is very challenging, so most of the videos you'll find are full of graphical glitches. Set in an alternate steampunk-style world, everything has started to go wrong with the arrival of seven great monsters appearing in each of the seven seas, some of which are not actually seas, sinking ships and bringing this new civilization to the brink of ruin. Lesser sea monsters and certain predators, including sharks of course, are also causing havoc, attacking people and wildlife alike. Bounties have been issued on these monsters and you intend to collect them. Despite what you might initially think based on the game's premise, sharks are just one of many hostile enemies to be found in the game. They are also one that you'll only find quite early on at that. The first sea will find you dealing with short fin mako sharks, but you'll spend just as much time fighting off barracuda and sea snakes. Eventually, you'll meet the mini-boss, a great white trying to eat this indecisive diver. Save him, and you'll get some health, and be rewarded by fighting the sea dragon, which is... a giant marine iguana. Wait, 1998? Right, so, the second sea is more shark-focused. The mako sharks have been joined by hammerheads which school together. Some will attack you, some won't. Though by the nature of this sort of game, the more you shoot, the more points you get. The Ocean Hunter is a game you probably won't get the chance to play. Sega never ported it to the Dreamcast or any other console, and without the gimmicks of more elaborate arcade cabinets or a big license like Jurassic Park or Star Wars, it's largely been forgotten. Whilst the lack of licenses would presumably mean there would be less legal hurdles importing or even remaking the game for modern systems, the death of the light gun as a peripheral would seem to make this very unlikely. The best chance would have probably been on the Nintendo Wii. The game's main antagonist is Rahab, a sea deity that is angered by humanity's disregard for the oceans and so created the other great monsters, whilst also influencing other aquatic creatures, as a means to humble us. You would think there might be some kind of moral here, but, well, you kill Rahab and things presumably just go back to the way they were. Video games aren't always very good with morals, are they? 1998. You know, I can make a segue out of that. Although Resident Evil was released in 1996, it's actually set in 1998. Now, you probably wouldn't think that a creepy mansion filled with zombies in the middle of a forest in North America could possibly have anything to do with sharks.
Richard!
But how wrong you are.
Chris! Chris, stop! No! Richard!
This is bioorganic weapon code Foxtrot India 3, otherwise known as Neptune. Of course, this isn't the original PlayStation version of the game. It's the 2015 high-definition remaster and digital re-release of the 2003 remake for the Nintendo GameCube. We're not gonna bother showing the original PlayStation version of Neptune. To be honest, it's just a bit too naff. Now, we're certainly not going to go into the Resident Evil lore at length here, there's plenty of other articles and videos out there for that. Suffice to say, the original Resident Evil was all about experiments with the T-virus. Amongst those experiments was infecting a great white shark. The results were actually disappointing. Apparently, the T-virus mutations did little to enhance the shark's strength and senses, nor did it suddenly gain the ability to breathe air and be an effective weapon out of water. Science, ladies and gentlemen. Umbrella Corporation-style science. It wasn't a total loss, though. It turned out that this shark was pregnant, and when the pups were born, the virus and related mutations had been passed on to them, something that the scientists were keen to research further. But that's getting into some disturbingly creepy areas to contemplate. There isn't really too much to talk about in terms of these sharks' portrayal. They are by no means normal great whites. They've been infected with a virus that has a bit of a reputation for eroding minds and turning humans into mindless flesh-eating zombies. Add to that the fact that they have been trapped in the flooded aqua ring for quite some time without food, and their hostility is hardly surprising. What might be more surprising, under the circumstances, is that Big Mama Neptune hasn't cannibalized her offspring. From Resident Evil to Bioshock, specifically the game's sequel. Bioshock 2 is certainly much maligned, but it does, however, have underwater sequences, seeing as you play as a big daddy. So first up, we have this little baby great white shark, which will just do these innocent little orbits on this section of the game. You can also see it in the main menu and title screen. But more interestingly, and perhaps appropriately, is another guest appearance by our good friend Hassankus. Yes, we've got a six-gill shark once again. The Bioshock Wikia seems a bit indecisive about what this species is, describing it as both an unknown shark and a bull shark, but this is most certainly Hassankus. Or possibly a seven-gill shark, which, as we have established, is even more powerful. Both sharks in Bioshock 2 are completely for show and cannot interact with the player in any way. This is Ace of Seafood. You can play as a fish. You can also play as a great white shark. And you can shoot lasers. I don't really have much more to say than that. World of Fishing is a free-to-play MMO, and one which I just simply had to include due to the sheer quantity of sharks available to catch in it. This game was a rather late addition to the video, and I only had a matter of weeks to try and catch as many sharks as I could in order to show you, but even then I haven't managed to capture even half of what's available, with a grand total exceeding 50 different types of shark. Being a free-to-play MMO, there are, of course, plenty of microtransactions, though it is worth pointing out that I managed to get to about level 40 within 2 weeks without having spent a penny. Initially, progress is quite swift, but this will begin to slow down drastically as you keep playing. And now, back to Steam Early Access again. This is Stranded Deep. There's been a huge explosion in the popularity of survival games since DayZ, and it was just a matter of time before someone made a version based on being marooned on a tropical island. Just a quick clarification, most of this was recorded back in July 2015 and the game has received a number of updates since then. It's looking a lot more pretty now, especially the ocean itself. As of June 2016 though, the 3D models of the sharks remain exactly the same, so let's proceed based on that. There are currently three species of shark in the game. The tiger shark, which is the most common and approaches the shallows quite often. The great white, of course, which tends to stay in the deepest waters between islands. And finally, the much smaller black-tip reef shark, which, in my experience, has turned out to be the hardest to find. The great white and tiger sharks are two of only three hostile animals in the game. The third is the marlin. Black-tips are passive and will generally flee if the player approaches or attacks. The 3D models are not great. They're pretty bad, actually, the models, textures, and animations. Now, as far as I'm aware, the models of at least the great white and tiger are just placeholders. I did try contacting the developers asking for more information about updated models, but never heard anything back, so take from that whatever you will. The model and textures for the black tip, which is a newer addition, are miles better, but still leave room for improvement. It's a bit difficult to talk about the AI and portrayal here, as it has changed so many times over the last year. When I first played the game in 2015, the sharks showed very little interest in the player. Attacks were quite rare and usually only happened when the shark was either provoked, or if you were swimming with open wounds and so bleeding into the water, which was refreshingly realistic. That's been tweaked though to make them really quite aggressive, and this has gone back and forth a bit ever since. It's understandable in a way, of course, this is still a game, and people tend to want to at least have some element of danger to stop things from getting boring. Speaking of survival, tropical islands and tiger sharks. Zorak, Chorocojo, please indulge us with a bit of Man vs. Wild starring Bear Grylls for the Nintendo Wii.
You know, the second I kill myself to these sharks, I'm gonna lose that.
That's fine. I'm fine with this. Acceptable losses.
Bring it, sharks. I can take you. I wonder if they're gonna have the actual thing where you can dodge the shark.
So I guess that yellow tang doesn't count as...
Come here, shark. No, they said tropical fish. They did count it.
Those are clownfish. What are they doing schooling with those?
This is how fast you have to go to escape a tiger shark.
You're teasing that poor shark.
Oh.
Ah! Oh god! The vicious tiger shark!
It pulled him under like an alligator.
Yeah, it did.
Sharks don't attack you like that, by the way.
No, they don't. Especially tiger sharks. Because their teeth are serrated, they cut right through your leg.
Yep, they just let you bleed out and tear you to pieces.
You will not notice that your fucking leg is gone.
No, you won't.
I need water.
God damn it, bear!
So, wait.
It seems like a terrible idea.
I don't know how I'm supposed to be doing this. I just press A? Oh, do I press A when it's at those places? Oh, I see. I was lost for a second there. Well, what do you actually want us to do?
As somebody who pulls people out of the water and sit like this, I'm going to say this is a terrible idea in every sense of the word.
Look at that eruption! Amazing!
Great!
Wait.
Thank God to rescue those hermit crabs, Zorak.
Man, I feel good about it now.
That is some a destructive flow right there.
Oh great, there's a shark chasing us.
Also, everything's on fire.
Or he's escaping.
Maybe it's a friendly dolphin. No, that's a shark. The shark is attacking you. Are you aware of this?
Oh god, I'm beating the shark up with a stick.
You know, I've seen tiger sharks.
They don't look like that. And they don't do that.
They don't do that. They don't look like that. They're not that mean.
Oops. I whiffed it. That means the shark's gonna attack me.
Ah! You know, after the first time, that shark would just bolt.
Oh, God. It's this acceleration mechanic.
I can't decide if this is stupider than the airboat.
I'd say it's stupider, actually. This is so fucking stupid. He is being his own airboat now.
Yeah, he is.
Oh, great. Now I'm gonna get attacked by another fucking tiger shark. Fucking great.
It's the same tiger shark, which is just as stupid, if not
what
stupider.
What did he do to this tiger shark to piss it off? He had to have done something.
He really wants those hermit crabs. Meanwhile, the fire in the background is really poorly rendered.
Yep. Oh, now time for more sharks. On the other hand, I can hear the helicopter.
You know, I'm fine with this. Go.
I'm not.
I know.
Fuck this noise. Wow, motherfucker.
It's a very smooth ocean today.
Yes, it is.
Especially considering there's a lot of geothermal activity going on in the background like that.
Yeah. I like that the game freaking out is making the shark make pig sounds. It makes no sense, but I love it. I'm swimming to I'm going to a different island?
Well, yes, clearly. Desert Island Zone, Act 2.
Oh my fucking god.
Definitely isn't over yet. Still gotta find some sort of civilization that could be out in this ocean for days.
No.
The helicopter can't see me from this angle.
Quick, call the Thundercats.
Hey, it's another search and rescue helicopter.
721056?
Yes, it is.
Hey!
They get around, don't they?
It's like they follow Bear. They know he's gonna get into stupid shit.
What's the largest ocean on the Earth? Pacific. How much of the Earth's total surface? I'd say... 30?
Let's go with 30.
Why can't you drink... it dehydrates you? All of the above, actually. Right?
I told you what it does, and it gives you diarrhea, dehydrates you, and it makes you delirious.
I'm going to say all of the above.
It's always, if the answer says all of the above, it's always all of the above.
Yep. When it comes to attacking humans, tiger sharks are second only to great white sharks.
We were attacked how many times by a tiger shark?
Water in the sunlight coconut is?
Sterile.
Oh man, we got so many survival points.
Great.
But who gives a shit?
Thanks again, guys. Mainly because you spared me from having to play that game myself. It's time for the big one. Depth is an asymmetrical team-based multiplayer game for PC. It's divers versus sharks. For divers, their goal is to collect treasure by protecting an unmanned underwater vehicle dubbed Steve, which stands for Submersible Treasure Extraction Vehicle. You want to get rich and survive. The goal of the sharks is to stop the divers. This is another example of a game which you really shouldn't overthink. At the end of the day, it's online multiplayer, which is just people versus people, and everyone's just playing to win. If you were playing as a shark and you really wanted to, you could completely ignore the divers and focus all of your efforts on Steve. Disabling or destroying the little sub is just one other way to achieve victory. It's no more a reflection of reality than people corpse humping in countless other multiplayer games out there. So don't overthink it too much. Despite the premise, the game isn't anti-shark any more than it's anti-diver, and openly acknowledges who the intruders are. I really don't think the game is trying to have an agenda or message, so it wouldn't really be fair to try and push one onto it. That said, if you're playing with bots, I'm not entirely sure that Valerie Taylor would really approve of her name being in there. What we do have is a decent selection of sharks, which have all been modelled and textured to a pretty good standard. This is easily the best Mako shark I've ever seen in a game, and I highlight that because there's been a fair few by now. In fact, this model looks more like an actual Mako than the CGI sharks in Deep Blue Sea. There are some issues to consider, of course. For the sake of gameplay balance, the sense of scale can be inconsistent. For example, there is no way that a thresher shark could fit a diver's legs in its mouth. The thresher is an example of a shark being added because it could bring interesting diversity to the gameplay mechanics rather than being a realistic threat to divers. Despite that, it's still the best thresher shark in a game by far, leagues apart from Endless Ocean 2. The Great Hammerhead also looks the part with the noticeably large fins. The Bull Shark? Well, it's very stocky and bulked up, so perhaps it's not representative of the average body shape and size for the species, but some particularly large and well-fed individuals won't look too far off. It's passable. The Great White is pretty spot on, and I appreciate the finer modelling details like how the teeth in the upper and lower jaws are different. In the real shark, the lower teeth are distinctly narrower, a bit more needle-like, and designed more for initially gripping their prey, whilst the upper teeth are wider, closer to being an equilateral triangle. Good stuff. In a game like this, the devs do have to give consideration to make sure the sharks don't look too similar to one another. What lets the game down a little bit on the visual front is the animations when they go full speed. Look at those floppy fins! Flippy floppy! Each of the sharks has a particular playstyle. It's not quite a class system like you would get in Team Fortress 2, but it's not just cosmetic either. These sharks mostly play very differently from each other. Each shark has a unique ability that can be triggered and has a cooldown period. As the sharks kill divers or target Steve, they earn evolution points that can be spent on improving various traits upon respawning. The Great White is a tank, a bit slower but lots of health and a devastating attack. Its special ability is Juggernaut, which reduces the amount of damage it takes for a 3-second period. At level 3, the shark will take half the normal amount of damage, as well as being immune to tranquilizers and nets. The Tiger Shark is the game's all-rounder. Since it has those distinctive stripes on its back, its ability is called Adaptive Hide. This basically makes the shark much harder to see for up to 5 seconds, allowing it to sneak up on players. The Mako is the Natural Scout, smaller and by far the fastest shark. It's quite weak and so not really suited to direct confrontation unless it's an opportunistic moment to pick off a weakened diver that's been caught alone. Its ability reflects this. Called Mark Prey, this basically puts a mark on any one diver for up to 15 seconds. If the diver is killed while the mark is active, the Mako will be granted evolution points despite not attacking directly. The Hammerhead plays a little differently from the other sharks. In the game, its jaws have been made very weak, and the most effective way for it to deal damage is to ram divers into solid objects. I'm sure you can get the implication given the shape of the head. Its ability is Relentless Force. This causes the shark to regain stamina whenever it rams a solid object. If the ability is maxed out, it will also regain health as well. The Thresher? Surely you can guess. It's small and weak if used conventionally, but its ability is using its tail as a whip, which is devastating and able to strike multiple divers at once. Finally, the newest addition is the Bull Shark. Its special ability is Enrage. When close to divers, the Bull Shark has a Rage Gauge, which gradually fills up. Using it applies a massive boost to health, stamina, and damage. This is obviously a reference to roid rage, and the often repeated quote that bull sharks have the highest levels of testosterone of any animal. Something that is played up in Grand Theft Auto 4 and 5 by Brucey Kibbutz. It's even become a usable item in GTA Online. Despite all that, there's no actual scientific evidence that it's true. It seems high testosterone levels are actually quite common in many fish. I'd recommend having a little read through this article on the subject. The link's also in the description if you'd rather check it later. All this comes together so that if you want to be successful in depth, teamwork is really important, critical even, especially for sharks, as you can use abilities that complement each other. There is, however, one more shark in depth with its own exclusive game mode. Right, I've been putting this off long enough. Let's talk a little bit about Megalodon. I just barely mentioned this giant prehistoric shark in the first video, since its only appearance amongst those titles was in Shark Hunting the Great White, where the final level of the game does have you hunting a megatooth shark, aka the Megalodon. Like all the other sharks in the game, it was very derpy to say the least. And yet, despite how silly it looks, oddly frightening when you find yourself clipping through it all the time. Megalodon has managed to get rather firmly entrenched in a lot of popular culture now. When people started getting used to seeing footage of great whites, including people swimming around with them without a cage, you need something to bring that sense of awe and dread back. What better way than a massive shark that was about three times the size? With novels, a few bad B-movies, and the Discovery Channel putting out fakeumentaries, plenty of people have now heard of Megalodon. Games are no different, so here's a little mini feature, Megalodons in Gaming. Back we go to 1998 and the Ocean Hunter once again. What, you didn't really think I just overlooked this, did you? The great sea monster of the game's second level, the Lunar Sea, is Leviathan, revealed to be a megalodon responsible for sinking 11 ships with 364 fatalities. This is a big, if somewhat decrepit looking shark. But once that mouth opens, hoo-hoo, that is a lot of teeth and they even reach out towards you. With its entourage of Mako Shark cronies and generally impressive appearance for 1998, it's little wonder that Leviathan would be used for much of the promotional material of the game. Whilst this might not look like too much now, you have to remember that this game appeared in the arcades at the same time as The Legend of Zelda Ocarina of Time, Metal Gear Solid, and Half-Life. It was also 60 frames per second, so this was really impressive stuff, far beyond what any hardware in the home could achieve, despite the Model 3 arcade board already being 2 years old by that point. The Ocean Hunter was released just over a year after Steve Alton's novel, Meg, hit the shelves. The release of this book may well have been what began the thrust of the Megalodon into popular culture. Whilst I can't state this for an absolute fact, it is possible that the Ocean Hunter is the first time a shark specifically identified as Megalodon appeared in a video game. We return to the realms of Steam Early Access here with Manowar Corsair. The best way I can describe this game would be like Assassin's Creed Black Flag or Rogue, but set in the Warhammer universe. The game version on show here is 0.2, so it's still really early days and very rough around the edges, but there is potential here for a more strategically minded approach to the template that Black Flag had made so streamlined and engaging. Unlike the Assassin's Creed games, you can expect to be attacked by wildlife at sea, and that includes Megalodon. This is a rather conventional take on the shark, which is basically that of a great white that's been considerably scaled up. At a glance, you might think the same about the Megalodon in depth, but they have actually made an entirely new model which has a bulkier body. The teeth and jaws are larger still, giving us a shark that looks like it was completely built around those giant gnashers. This is more in line with most current theories about what Megalodon probably looked like, and you can see the differences here as we compare it with the game's Great White model. Megalodon was truly a less eloquent design from a completely uncivilized age. In terms of the game itself, these two models are actually being shown to scale, so as we can see, the Megalodon has been scaled down quite a bit. Our little Meg side quest shall end with Ark, Survival Evolved. This is another early access game, though it is also available on Xbox One. A year after release, updates still seem to pop up regularly and the users remain happy. As the name rather suggests, Ark is another survival game, but a rather more ambitious one than Stranded Deep, with an expansive online multiplayer component. With dinosaurs, which you can tame and ride, there are swarms of megalodons literally infesting the waters offshore. Now, it's worth pointing out that the animals in Ark are technically not the animals we know once existed in our world. For example, it's not Tyrannosaurus Rex in Ark, it's Tyrannosaurus Dominum. This is how the game justifies why many species are different and often much larger than they actually were. Megalodon is actually described as Carcharodon Ultramegalodon, but let's not get into the taxonomy debate here. The funny thing is that many people complained that the game's megalodons were far too small. That seems like a bit of a stretch. While it's a bit messy and cobbled together, I made this comparison about a year ago. The purpose was to show that the size isn't really that far off. Some people claim that the humans shrink when they ride the Megalodon, but I've also compared the player character to the dorsal fin whilst not riding it, and if the player does shrink, it doesn't seem to be by very much. What is more likely to blame here is things like a very wide field of view setting, which most PC gamers absolutely insist on. One of the side effects tends to be that it makes things look smaller. Oh, yeah, you heard me right, and saw the picture as well, I suppose. Yes, in Ark you can actually tame a Megalodon, make a harness for it, and then ride it around the oceans as your mighty steed, provided you have a means of keeping yourself warm and, well, oxygenated. I'm outright cheating here by enabling console commands because yay for PC. It makes capturing video much easier. The size issue does persist though, and it's understandable when you think about it. If so many other animals in the game are much bigger than they really were, then why shouldn't the same apply to Ultra Megalodon? Well, this is PC, so naturally, there's a mod for that. Now that is a big shark, and you can still tame it. And you can still ride it. But how can you really top the novelty of riding and controlling a shark that is easily over 100 feet long, a size closer to the initial estimates from the early 1900s? So, is Megalodon still alive in our oceans today? Honestly, almost certainly not, and definitely not in the way that the Discovery Channel was showing a few years ago with its fictional dramas disguised as documentaries. That being that they are freely swimming around our oceans in the epipelagic or mesopelagic zones, and we've just been incredibly unlucky, or perhaps that should be lucky, to have never encountered them. A Lazarus taxon, that being an animal which disappeared from the fossil record for one or two periods only to be rediscovered, is a very real thing. One of the most famous examples being the coelacanth. But there is a huge difference between a deep sea fish eater that grows up to 2 metres and a 16 to 20 metre long super predator that we've somehow never managed to catch in all those fishing nets out there. Keep in mind that the coelacanth was always being caught by those local fishermen in those parts of the world. It was just unknown to modern science that this was happening until 1938. Again, a bit of a difference between a human-sized fish and a predator larger than most whales. Let's think about this for a second. Whilst it's true that when a shark dies, its corpse will tend to just sink and quickly be devoured, that doesn't mean that the remains of sharks don't ever wash up on our beaches. It's not remotely uncommon for just about any species of shark, whale or dolphin to become beached, alive or dead. Whale sharks, basking sharks, great whites, we find their remains washed up quite often. It's just one of those things that happens. Even open ocean species like oceanic white tips and mako sharks, or even deep sea species such as goblin sharks and megamouth sharks, will wash up on beaches from time to time. Yet not once has anyone ever discovered a washed up megalodon or something that could be even remotely identified as such. Remember, we are talking about what would easily be the largest fish in the ocean, twice the size of a whale shark. Now, that alone is not entirely conclusive, but there's something else that's never washed up or been seen. Animals, in particular whales, showing signs of being attacked by such a massive shark. This is one of the biggest problems. It's not just that we don't see Megalodon itself, we also don't see any evidence that it's feeding. Consider this. The 18th century, the height of traditional whaling. It wasn't really possible to haul entire whales out of the water to strip them for blubber. If you've read Moby Dick or done any sort of research in traditional whaling, you might be familiar with the term flensing or cutting in. The dead whale was secured along the side of the ship and sailors would descend on platforms and use flensing knives to cut into the animal. Cuts would be made into the blubber in specific ways before hooks were used to basically peel the blubber away in sheets. This is usually compared to peeling an orange. Basically, the bulk of the animal was processed while it was still in the water, and this process had to be done as quickly as possible because it was an absolute feast for marine predators, especially sharks. It's the ultimate chum and was the ultimate bait for a megalodon. Yet there are no tales of truly monstrous sharks the size of the whales themselves devouring these catches, and my goodness, there were a lot of whaling boats and a lot of whales being killed. As for the deepest depths, well, if a megalodon population was to exist down there, then in order to adapt to the different conditions, it would surely have changed beyond any recognition and no longer actually be a megalodon. It would have evolved into something else. Whilst it's absolutely true that most of the ocean remains unexplored, and it might seem obvious that a massive super predator could still be out there, there are some pretty big issues, and it's these which are what make it extremely unlikely. And we certainly don't need any suggestions of massive international conspiracies between multiple governments and scientific bodies on a scale that would be worthy of the La Le Lu Le Lo. Megalodon was an awesome animal, a true marvel of nature. It's incredibly unlikely that any one event led to its extinction, but rather a combination of multiple factors all coming together against it. In the end, Megalodon may have just simply been too specialized to adapt to a changing world. Whew, wow, we're still going here. What next? How about something big budget and AAA that you can find on just about any format? Call of Duty Ghosts was the first COD game on 8th generation consoles, so it was given some special hype. In particular, we were wowed by the claims of advanced fish AI and...
mocap dogs! Mocap dogs! 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 Forget about those dogs from Modern Warfare 3, they were shit! Proper dogs! Proper ones!
So, we have sharks. Tiger sharks again. That seems to be quite the running theme for this video. We're told straight away to keep our distance and avoid open water. Follow this advice and these sharks really don't care about you being there. If you decide to ignore this crystal clear advice, well, you didn't think they were just for show, did you? Shooting the sharks will also prompt an instant attack. It's possible to kill them in your first encounter, but later on there just isn't enough time, so your punishment for being so gung-ho shall be swift. The modelling and texture work here is pretty decent. The tiger stripes aren't too overdone, which is good because they are something that fade as the sharks age into adulthood. They are also fairly slender, the tail's reasonably proportioned, and they have the very broad and rounded nose that helps define the species. Then we have the teeth. Oh dear, well that's not right, not at all. These teeth look a bit closer to a sand tiger shark. And even then it's pretty far off. This is a tiger shark tooth, and if that shape looks a bit familiar to you, this is probably why. These are quite possibly the most perfectly evolved teeth in nature. It's a bite that has no problem carving through thick turtle shells. Another little nitpick from the attack sequence would be that there's no nictitating membrane protecting the eye. It's the little details. If the devs are going to try and make a big deal out of advanced fish AI and
mocap dogs,
they can at least get the shark's eyes and teeth right. It's a AAA title after all. The level itself is set off the coast of South America, which is mostly within the tiger shark's range. They can typically be found as far south as northern Argentina on the Atlantic side, and as far south as central Chile on the Pacific side. Returning yet again to Steam Early Access, this is Shark Attack Deathmatch 2, the sequel to an Xbox 360 indie game, strange as that might sound to say. Despite the name, this isn't actually a game about sharks, nor is it really an asymmetrical game like Depth. The core mode of the game is, in fact, diver versus diver deathmatches. Where the sharks come into it is as an ambient creature which may or may not interfere in attack players. According to the developers, factors like blood in the water will affect the aggressiveness of the sharks. So this game is probably the closest you will come to reenacting the final underwater battle scene from the James Bond movie Thunderball. There are no bots in Shark Attack Deathmatch 2, at least not yet. Instead, the single player portion of the game is a more straightforward survival mode to kill as many sharks as possible to get a high score. These survival maps are made of large sharks like the Great White, which provide a score multiplier, and smaller sharks like Blacktip Reef Sharks or Bull Sharks, which don't. To get the higher scores, you want to try to avoid these smaller sharks and only focus on the large ones, which, for the most part, will only spawn one at a time. Survive for 10 minutes and you win. The survival mode could almost be called a spiritual successor to Shark Hunting the Great White. Added more recently to the game is a shark versus diver mode called Predator. It's basically a juggernaut game type, which would be this game's equivalent to the Megalodon hunt in Depth. Unlike in Depth and most other games with a juggernaut game mode, the Great White has some help in the form of AI Mako Shark cronies which the player can give basic commands to. They can be sent away to actively attack divers or instructed to try and protect you. So that's the game itself, really. It looks pretty good for what it is, and has an extremely low asking price, so let's look at the sharks themselves in more detail. First up is the Great White. This is really quite a well done model, easily the best in the game. Perhaps that's because of more readily available reference material, or perhaps it's always going to have been the poster boy for a game like this, and so more time and attention was dedicated to it. The Blacktip Reef Sharks and Bull Sharks are also pretty decent. The bull sharks might be a little on the small side, but the game basically seems to only have just two sizes, large and small, and for whatever reason, they've been classified as the latter. The tiger shark is decent enough, the proportions are mostly there, as is that large blunt snout. Wrong teeth again, though you'll not get that much chance to actually see them. It's a running theme that the tail always seems to cause difficulty for modelers. Wow, there have been a lot of tiger sharks today. I talked a little bit about the real animal earlier, so let's cut to Zorak for the final time today.
Hey, look who's still skulking around here. It's a big ol' mean ol' shark ol' old tiger shark. With a rather amusing scientific name. Cuvier didn't actually name it, it's more of a tribute to him. Cuvier being, yours is Cuvier. Was a rather famous French zoologist. He established the concept of extinction in biology, amongst other things. Tiger sharks are fairly notable as far as sharks go, and I'd like to tell you a little bit about them. The tiger shark, Galeocerdo cuvier, is a member of the Requiem shark family, Carcharhinidae. The Requiem sharks are known for being the family of sharks most prone towards attacks on humans, including individuals such as the bull shark, the blue shark, and the oceanic white-tip shark. Of course, the vast majority of Requiem sharks are very passive, and the amount of injuries caused by the more aggressive individuals is in fact extremely small. The tiger shark is a relatively large shark, capable of reaching a length of over 5 meters, or 16 feet, making large individuals rival the great white in length. Some individuals have even been measured at up to 7 meters, well over 20 feet long.
This size helps make the tiger shark one of the apex predators of the tropics. The tiger shark will eat basically anything. Fish, jellyfish, cephalopods, crustaceans, dugongs, seabirds, sea snakes, dolphins, seals, sea turtles, other sharks, even other tiger sharks. They basically will try to eat anything that moves and is smaller than them. Tiger sharks around Hawaii are often found with horse, goat, sheep, dog, cat, or rat in their stomachs. Mostly, it is believed, from scavenging. They will also eat inanimate objects, like tires, oil cans, and pretty much anything humans throw into the ocean. One of the neat adaptations of the tiger shark is its teeth. A tiger shark's teeth are incredibly strong and sharp, in part specialized for being able to saw through a sea turtle's shell. In fact, tiger sharks will eat every single kind of sea turtle, including the massive leatherback sea turtle, though they tend to focus on smaller individuals. Tiger sharks are not high-speed predators, nor are they pack hunters. A tiger shark swims around alone, slowly, almost sluggishly, prowling for signs of prey. When they do detect potential prey, either using their wonderful sense of smell or excellent eyesight or their ampullae Lorenzi, they will use their powerful muscles to strike in a burst of speed. Their slowness actually works very much to the benefit of the tiger shark. It allows them to conserve energy while making it difficult for their prey to detect them coming. As the tiger shark is one of the sharks most prone to attacking humans, they are one of the sharks that most often suffers from culling and shark vengeance kills. Between 1959 and 1976, nearly 5,000 sharks were killed around Hawaii, funded by Hawaii's tourism industry in an attempt to reduce attacks. It had almost no effect. The tiger shark is also routinely captured for its fins, flesh, and liver. Its liver has a high concentration of vitamin A, which is used to make vitamin oils. The fins of the tiger shark is used in shark fin soup, a traditional Chinese luxury dish served at weddings, and they are a preferred capture for this purpose due to the size of their fins. However, the tiger shark's numbers thus far have not been heavily impacted by finning, though this may be changing. While the tiger shark indeed attacks humans, the vast majority of these attacks arise out of misidentification, just like with the great white shark. Low visibility conditions in areas of turbulent surface waters can lead to bites when the shark confuses humans for its more preferred prey, such as seals. While it is not recommended due to their curiosity and propensity towards eating, well, anything, it is possible to swim safely amongst tiger sharks in conditions with better visibility and no chum in the water. They are far from being mad man-eaters. As with all sharks and animals in general, one must be aware of the risks associated with them and show them respect, ideally from a distance. Plus, as we've established before, tiger sharks are notorious for feeding on Bear Grylls. So really, they can't be all that bad.
Good stuff. The short-finned mako sharks here are a little bit of a step down. Like the bull shark, they are also on the small side. Depth did such a good job of modelling the mako and its teeth that it raised the bar, so the shortfalls here are just that much more noticeable. Finally, we have the spotted ragged tooth shark. Well, that's a South African name, so I assume the game developers are also South African. In Australia, it's known as the grey nurse shark. In most of the world, including the UK and North America, we know it best as the sand tiger shark. I'm going to be a bit blunt here, this model isn't great. It's easily the weakest in the game, and it stands out because the great white is so much better. Firstly, for whatever reason, the sand tiger has been classified as one of the game's bonus-giving large sharks. I'm really not sure why. Whilst they are by no means a small shark, it's quite rare for them to exceed 3 meters. Both bull sharks and sand tiger sharks tend to average similar lengths. So why we have these giant sand tigers and rather small bull sharks together on the same map is a bit of a mystery to me personally. Short-finned mako sharks are much more likely to grow large than either of these species, with the largest verified mako being almost 4.5 meters long. On top of all this, the sand tiger doesn't really have a particularly bad reputation, and I'm not aware of a single absolutely confirmed fatality by the species. They are actually one of the more common sharks to find in aquariums due to their generally docile nature, despite their size and appearance. Accidents and attacks do happen, of course, but it's a matter of keeping things in proportion. The teeth of a sand tiger shark lack serrations and are instead quite needle-like, so whilst their bites can be very messy and ragged, they are less likely to remove large chunks of flesh, especially as they tend to target smaller fish species. If it was up to me, personally, I would probably remove the sand tiger from the game and replace it with something like the great hammerhead, simply because it is a truly massive predatory shark, while still being very distinctive. Perhaps the developers were just trying to avoid using too many species that were already being used in depth, but the funny thing is that there aren't actually that many very large predatory sharks that are implicated in attacks, so it can actually be a bit more challenging than you might expect. Ah, the end is in sight. Let's finish up by looking at some new technology, virtual reality. Unfortunately, there are some limitations here in terms of what footage I could obtain due to not having a proper PC headset myself. First up is Ocean Rift, which is available right now, and this is a closer look at its great white. It's not the only virtual reality experience to use the cage diving with a great white scenario, but it's worth highlighting for being the only dynamic one I know of, by which I mean Ocean Rift isn't a pre-scripted scenario. Everything has AI, so every time you play should be different. One of the plus points of Ocean Rift is that it is available for Samsung's Gear VR. So if you have a Samsung phone, this is a rather more affordable way to try it out. Dynamic AI is not always the case, as a lot of VR software and experiences out there are basically technology demos. One of these technology demos, which is now being further developed into part of a full experience, is Sony's Into the Deep for PlayStation VR. Now, this is a completely scripted scenario. The shark is going to behave the same exact way each and every time. The benefit of this approach, though, well, just look at this shark. In making this, the modelers and animators have plainly spent a very long time looking at an awful lot of cage diving videos of great whites. The amount of subtle animations put in there is, quite frankly, amazing. There is visible muscle flexing and the gills react to water being forced over them as it takes a little bite at nothing. The fins almost casually run across the cage bars without any clipping. The jaws are not a solid part of the 3D model but instead move independently, being suspended from the skull instead, which is how a real shark's jaws work. I don't mean to sound like I'm gushing, but a huge amount of effort went into all these details and it deserves to be acknowledged. Even the eyes seem to roll back as it opens its mouth wide to attack the cage. I just wish there was some better quality footage to use besides this official Sony sample. At last, finally, we have reached the end of this incredibly long video, which I could even call a documentary at this point if I was feeling particularly pretentious. There is but one final question I wish to ask. What is the greatest tiger shark in gaming? We saw an awful lot of them today, ranging from Call of Duty Ghosts to Depth. So out of all of these games, which one truly has the best, most accurate tiger shark? The answer? 2010's Endless Ocean 2 for the Nintendo Wii. Yes, despite the hardware limitations of Nintendo's little box forcing a lower polygon count and lower resolution textures, Arika seemed to have somehow managed to capture the general essence of what looks like a convincing tiger shark. And with that, I bid you all farewell. Thank you for watching.